So let's break down congestive heart failure. We've already said that the heart's not able to, or it's not strong enough to efficiently pump an adequate amount of volume of blood to the rest of the body. Then fluid begins to back up within the circulation. That's where the fluid builds up in the lungs and it begins to fill the alveoli with fluid. So now instead of alveoli, you got little water balloons in your lungs. Okay, now I know that's a concept you've probably heard before. I want to invite a friend to help us understand this even more. This is a friend from my childhood. I love this game. Oh, wagga, 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 wagga. Maybe you recognize it. Yeah, I know. You probably play it in some really cool retro places. But I'm going to use this little guy to walk us through the flow of blood so you're rock solid on what happens in congestive heart failure. Okay, so this is going to involve your pencil or your finger because I want you to trace the blood with our little friend there, our tour guide, through the system. Now, in a normal pump, I'm talking about a heart and a system that's working efficiently, right? There's no problems. The heart hasn't had a heart attack because, you know, in a heart attack, you end up myocardial infarction. You end up with dead tissue, and a dead tissue is stiff tissue. So stiff tissue doesn't expand and contract efficiently. That's another cause of CHF, a heart that's taken a hit. We're not looking at a heart like that. We're going to look at a normal, healthy, functioning heart. Okay, so a normal pump, that's what we're looking at. So unoxygenated blood, put your finger right on my little friend there, little Pac-Man-like guy. Put your finger right there. No, I'm serious. Don't just listen to my voice. Get your body involved. That's a great way to remember information in your brain. Okay, so this is unoxygenated blood returning to the heart on the right side. Now, our little friend there is coming up from the bottom, right? It's coming up from my legs. But if you have your finger there, if you trace it in, remember you also have unoxygenated blood coming down from your head too. So you see, you got those two vessels. So trace those two vessels, the superior and the inferior, coming back to the right atrium. All right, now the unoxygenated blood enters the heart at the right atrium. So make sure you've got that clear in your mind. It's coming from my lower extremities and down from my head. Now I'm in the right atrium. Now after that, do you remember the name of the valve that it goes through? Okay, cool. If you're not really solid on heart anatomy, you will be by the time we're done with this video series. So the unoxygenated blood came in my right atrium. Now we're down in the right ventricle. The valve that it passes through is the tricuspid valve. Now, tri sounds like right to me, so that's how I always remember that the tricuspid valve is on the right side of the heart. So, right atrium, unoxygenated blood through the tricuspid valve into the right ventricle. So you've got your finger there, you see that's where we are. Now for the right ventricle, the blood travels with the pulmonary artery into the lungs. Whoa. Okay, so look at that. We've kind of stretched it out for you so you can see it. You know, this isn't exactly what it would look like all compacted in your body, but it's a great way for you to grasp the concepts. Right atrium, tricuspid valve, right ventricle to both the lungs, the right and left lungs. So right ventricle pushes unoxygenated blood through the pulmonary artery. Remember, it's called the pulmonary artery because it's taking blood away from the heart. That's why its name is artery, going to the lungs to get oxygenated. So strong functioning heart, unoxygenated blood, right atrium. Through the tricuspid valve, right ventricle, then it goes to both the right and the left lungs. Now the blood picks up oxygen in the lungs. Yeah, that's a good thing. And it comes back to the heart on both sides. So you're coming back from both the right and the left lung to the left atrium. Okay, so in the left atrium, it's going to pass through the mitral valve into the left ventricle. Okay, right atrium, tricuspid, right ventricle, both the lungs, right, to get oxygenated, comes back to the left atrium, goes through the mitral valve into that left ventricle. Now, the left ventricle's job is to send blood out to up and down, right, up to my brain, down to the rest of my body, carrying oxygen. All right, so we've got that. Just a quick review of heart anatomy. Now, pause the video and see if you can trace that blood, naming the valves, naming whether it's oxygenated or not, trace it all the way from the brain and the body, all the way through the left ventricle, back out to the body. Okay, welcome back. I hope you took advantage of doing that a couple times, because don't make the mistake that a lot of us make. We think, yeah, that makes sense now while she's saying it. Yeah, of course it does, because it's like we're singing karaoke, right? I'm the words on the screen and you're going along with me and it makes sense. But that doesn't mean you've encoded it in your brain yet. So you're capable of it, more than capable of understanding this stuff, but it takes time and repetition. So make sure you've paused it, you've done it multiple times, so you have it rock solid without even having to look at it. You can picture it in your own mind. Then you know you're ready to move forward. All right, now let's talk about congestive heart failure. This is when it is not a healthy, strong, functioning, normal pump. This heart is having problems. That's why we call it congestive heart failure. That means the heart is failing, and congestive is like if your nose is all stuffed up. That's one of the problems. That's the same thing in congestive heart failure. Things are backing up, things are swollen, the heart is failing. So you've got a normal heart and a congestive failure heart right there. See, you've got that thickening of that ventricular chamber, that wall. Now, see if you can recall, why did that happen? What is one chronic problem that can be a big factor in causing a thick left ventricular wall? Cool. Did you remember that it's hypertension? Right. If that left ventricle is having to work really hard because all the vessels in my body are clamped down, that means the afterload or the workload of the heart has to push the blood out through those vessels, then that's a higher afterload. It gets thicker, which is helpful initially, but remember, then it's too much of a good thing and the heart becomes stiff and not able to really fully empty. So in CHF, that's why the heart can't keep up. It can't pump strong enough to keep that good balance. So fluid begins to back up. Now, you already know the answer to my next question. You really do. If you've walked with me through the other stuff, if you've paused the video and you've practiced, you've got this. So here's where your extra effort is really going to pay off. Okay, so let's rewind. We're going to talk about what happens in congestive heart failure. So normally, when we look at this slide, remember where the blood has gone. I know, let's go through it just one more time. Remember, blood comes from here and here into my right atrium. Then it goes through the valve, tricuspid valve. Then it's in the right ventricle. Then it goes to the lungs. Dump off that CO2, pick up the oxygen, come back to the left atrium. Okay, now we're all together. You see our guide is right there in the left atrium. Then the blood that's now been oxygenated, right? It's coming back through the pulmonary vein because veins bring blood back to the heart. Now it should move through the mitral valve into the left ventricle. The problem is, in a normal heart, it would pump it out, through the rest of the body, everything would be wonderful. No, that's not what happens, sadly, in congestive heart failure. This heart has a ventricle that's not strong enough to efficiently pump that blood out to the rest of the body. Okay, now we have a real problem. That's critically important that that left ventricle be strong enough to push blood out to the rest of the body. Congestive heart failure, it's not. So what happens? What happens to a ventricle can't pump blood out efficiently? Well, blood backs up where? Well, the next likely spot is going to be the left atrium, right? So it's going to go backwards. It's supposed to be going this way, but now it's going to back up. So it's going to go into the left atrium and it's going to back up into both of the lungs. Since that left ventricle is not strong enough to keep blood moving the direction it's supposed to go, it's going to start backing up. Now, when it starts backing up, you're going to have extra fluid hanging around and seeping out of the blood tissues, right, into the tissues. So we've got extra fluid volume seeping out of the blood supply into the tissues. When we're talking about the lungs, Those are the alveoli. So those little alveoli that are supposed to be these open little balls that exchange CO2 for O2 now become water balloons. All right. So that is one of the primary causes of pulmonary edema. Now, before you go on, I want you to pause the video, go back and review that, and see if, pretend you're trying to teach someone else why congestive heart failure causes pulmonary edema. Just do it one more time, and I promise you'll have it down solid.